You know, I thought about, like, I'm going to speak about the Holy Spirit this morning as well. I thought, God's so good, like, he set it all up, because Edgar and I, we didn't really, you know, like, I didn't really talk to him about what he was going to do. He didn't really talk to me what he was going to do, so, but God lined it all up anyway. So before Edgar spoke on the laying on of hands and the gifts, I did a session with the ladies, which was about the spiritual gifts. So when Edgar talked about the laying on of hands and the spiritual giftings, some people knew, you know, what kind of giftings there actually are. So that worked out beautifully. And then Edgar said he's going to continue with his message next Sunday. So we've got this one in the middle, and I had already planned a Holy Spirit message. So it must be on the cards for us, Holy Spirit. And I think it's going to be, it is going to be important for us. We, for quite some time, we haven't really talked about the Holy Spirit as such, because there's always lots of other topics, and the Holy Spirit is a constant companion, I guess, in our services. But, you know, just recently, I've been thinking, we had a national renewal conference, and Roland Baker was there. So for those who were there, you know what happened. For those of you who weren't, before Roland Baker started speaking, he ministered in Holy Joy, and it went on for a bit, and it went a bit crazy, and I have to admit, I was not comfortable. Like, we have been, you know, ministering in the Holy Spirit, and we're used to it. But I was sitting there and I thought, oh, does it have to go on for that long? And, you know, people all on the floor and laughing, and it's a bit, you know, and then you feel for those Lutherans that are a little bit more conservative and they just wanted to check it out. And there's all this going on and you go, oh. And I wasn't the only one. I talked to Helen and she said, yeah, I was a bit uncomfortable too. But I know it was God. And then when Roland came to our congregation a little bit earlier this year, same thing happened, you know, you're scheduled to speak, and so, you know, like, I'm expecting the preaching to start, but now he starts ministering, and people are on the floor, and they're laughing, and some people go, you know, that's weird, and I'm going, yeah, I know. So, again, I was not comfortable, and I did feel for those people who came and checked it out, but it made me think, I know it was God, and I know when Roland came here and ministered in the joy, he left a deposit. He left something of the joy here. And, you know, a couple of weeks after, it was when Edgar was preaching here and cracked up laughing and couldn't stop himself. So I know it was God. And yet, and we have been on this journey. We're even teaching about the Holy Spirit in other congregations. And yet, I'm still uncomfortable. And so I've been thinking, oh, why is that? You still think, yeah, you're all mature in the faith and you've developed and you're still uncomfortable. And I would think that I'm probably not the only one. There may be some of you who feel the same. It's not that new, though. Like, the very first instance when the Holy Spirit appeared in Acts, and that's in Acts 2, 1 and 5, it says, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. So suddenly there's a sound of blowing of the blowing of a violent wind, and the whole house is filled with that inside, which is a bit weird. Oh, okay, children's ministry. I wasn't sure. Sorry, guys. That is it, holidays already, you know. So if the children would like to leave. So there's the violent wind, and then they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in tongues as the Spirit enabled them. So it was a little bit out there. It was a little bit weird with the Holy Spirit that you can see on people, like tongues of fire. There's a violent wind. But apparently, just looking from the outside, it wasn't such a spiritual experience, because some people sort of said, you know, those guys are drunk, like they're babbling away. So it's not like it was a highly spiritual experience, or it looked like a highly spiritual experience. And people were sort of upset. And you sort of wonder, you know, like, why is that? Why does God keep challenging us, and even at the point where we are at now, like God is still challenging us, you know, as of throwing something in our path that makes us wonder. Now, the Holy Spirit always causes a stir. It did back then, and it still does today. And the problem, I guess, for us is that nowhere in the Bible there's a neat and tidy description of what is supposed to happen when the Holy Spirit comes. Like, and the thing is, the first time, you know, there was the wind and the tongues, which is good, but then it doesn't happen again like that. Like, other things happen. People start speaking in tongues and start prophesying. They may fall to the ground, but, you know, the tongues of fire, that doesn't appear again. So you think, well, God, why can't you just give us a neat, tidy description to look like when the Holy Spirit comes? Would make it so much easier. Why is that, do you think? Well, I thought about that. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
It's not a formula.
Sort of like, that's my take. I thought, for one thing, it allows God to be creative. Like, he may do it one way, but then a little bit later on, he does it in a different way. And he's a creative God. But I think the bigger thing is it allows him to stay in control. We tend to be a bit like that. If we have a neat description of how things are meant to look like, then, you know, you can sort of tick off. You can sort of go, okay, well, if falling down is allowed, but laughing's not allowed, then if there's any laughing, you can sort of go, no, we don't want that. At the conference, for me, if I could have set rules, I probably would have gone, no, the laughing's fine, but not for that long, and not into the mic. Like, you know, that's just making a big deal of it. And maybe first the preaching and then the laughing. So, you know, it's very easy for us to set the agenda, but God doesn't want that. He wants us to, he wants himself to set the agenda. It made me think that, you know, like, I was a bit at the conference as well. I was trying to watch out for others and sort of going, yeah, I don't really want people to be offended or upset. I want them to have the Holy Spirit in a way that it's really easily accessible to them. But God didn't think like that. He puts his Spirit, he puts what he wants us to have out there, and we sometimes have to step a little bit over a hurdle. It's a little bit like God saying, no, do you want me that much that you can see past your own perceptions? And God, made me think that God is like that. God the Father, you know, sometimes he upsets us and he doesn't mind upsetting us. You know, who of us hasn't been upset at God for allowing something to happen to me or to, you know, to your family or to those around you? Or who hasn't been upset with, back then, with Jesus? Like, he upset plenty of people with the way he preached or with healing on the Sabbath. And then the Holy Spirit keeps upsetting us. But I think God is quite purposely sometimes upsetting us so we can look past ourselves and look at what he actually wants to give us. Just a very brief point on, you know, like, when we were walking through the tunnel, what do we actually receive? It's a bit like when you walk through and it can feel like you're being filled with something, and that's even the language of the Bible. It sort of says that God is pouring out his Spirit on people, so it's almost like a substance, like a fluid. Being filled with the Holy Spirit again, it's like a substance or a fluid, and it feels a little bit like that. If you're walking through it, it can feel like you're immersed in a substance. But, like, we know that it's a triune God, and the Holy Spirit is one person of the triune God, so he's really a person. So the point is that when we experience the Holy Spirit, it's not just, you know, being filled with some sort of substance. It's actually an an intimate relationship with one person. And the Bible talks about the Spirit as an advocate who, you know, speaks up for us, a person who has emotions, who has a will, who has a mind. And I think that puts it in an amazing context to think that, yes, we're supposed to have a close relationship with God the Father, but we also need a close relationship with the Spirit, and the Spirit is actually a person residing in us. It can be a little bit confusing, you know, like I'm going to talk about the purposes of the Holy Spirit, because everyone, it doesn't matter how many books you read, every book points out a different purpose or focuses on a different purpose. Some say the Holy Spirit is for holy living, certainly truth in that. Others say it's for opening the scriptures and revealing the truth, and there's some truth in that. Others say it's for power, so that we can actually minister with power. We had, was it 3 weeks ago, we had a visit from a Ugandan pastor. He came up with one of the renewal guys from Adelaide, needed to catch up with us, and that Ugandan pastor, Richard, he had an interesting story. And again, it sort of illustrated that how the Holy Spirit can work and what the purposes of the Holy Spirit are. So he said, he's currently, I think he's got a congregation of about 400 people. And he's been in ministry for about 25 years. So he said there was one incident early on in his ministry that was really impacting. And that was when he had been ministering for about a year, and he said he was that more, and at that time he wasn't entirely sure, like he knew he was meant to serve God, but he wasn't sure in what capacity, so he kept asking God, just tell me what is the purpose of my life, what do you want me to do? Okay, so then one morning, on a Saturday morning, he went into the bank, Ugandan bank, with one of the ladies from his church, and there were planning to get some money out of the bank for church purposes. So then the bank, he's lined up, and while he's waiting in line, a couple of guys with masks and machine guns come into the bank and start shooting at the ceiling. They order everyone to go get down on the floor, and he's about to go down on his knees and go down on the floor when he hears God speak to him. And like, that's his words. God says to him, don't you know that you have my Holy Spirit inside you? How dare you take the creator of the universe who is inside you and lay me down on the floor with everyone else? Basically telling him, I want you to remain standing. He's like, okay, great. So he remains standing, trying to be unobtrusive so they don't notice him. And then God says to him, don't just stand there, begin to pray. So he's praying quietly under his breath, so he's not noticed. And God then says to him, son, I can't hear you. Raise your voice and pray out loud. He's like, okay. Puts his hands up and starts praying. And you know, everyone's attention is on him, of course, including the thugs. So one of the robbers comes up to him, and his approach to dealing with it is that he starts loading the gun and shooting at him. As that happens, Richard goes into he has a vision, and he says he sees the earth as a spinning globe, and God is lighting up different parts of the world and tells him that these are the parts. Now I'm giving you the purpose of your life, that's what you've been asking for, and these are the parts where you will be ministering and where you will be preaching the gospel. So that's nice, probably not a great moment, but like, that's good. The vision recedes, and the guy with the machine gun is still standing in front of him. By the time he's emptied his magazine, and Richard is standing there without a scratch on him. The robbers are so frustrated that they leave the building without the money. So Richard then says, like, he spent a short time just preaching the gospel. He says, you know, this is what Jesus can do. Turn to Jesus. And he leaves the building. He storms out of the building. I thought, like, when I heard the testimony, I thought, it just reflects how God works. You know, here you are asking for the purpose of your life, and I'm pretty sure he would have expected God to come, you know, in his quiet time, doing a worship song, but no, like it's, while the bank's being robbed, while he's being shot at, he receives his, you know, his commission. And it also shows that God does not care what you look like. You know, here you are in the bank, praying out like a lunatic, like a religious lunatic out loud. But God doesn't care. He doesn't care if we look a little bit like idiots at times. It's more important to him that we are obedient. What was the purpose of the Spirit in this testimony? Well, for one thing, I think the Spirit led Richard to give a testimony to God, like he spoke about the gospel. And the other one is just, you know, really being able to trust God. The Gospels tell us that Jesus was baptized and he was filled with the Holy Spirit as well, which I thought was interesting because he's one person of the Trinity. Why would he need the Holy Spirit? He's got companionship with the Holy Spirit anyway. And so really, if we look at, once you start looking at Luke and what happened to Jesus, we can see quite clearly why we actually need the Holy Spirit. Like if Jesus was filled with the Holy Spirit and there were certain reasons for it, these are the reasons why we need the Holy Spirit. And I guess why the message is all the more important for us now is that I do believe, like as Living Grace, we are... Like, this is a new season, that's what we said at the start of the year, and things, you know, they can go a little bit crazy and you don't see the results straight away. But I know, like, already now, we are stepping out, we are starting to be, we have plans to leave the LCA, there are new things lined up for us, and for that, I think it is really, really important to focus on how God is leading us and having the power of God in us so that we can actually go and do what God sets before us. Now, when Jesus was being baptized, he was praying, heaven was opened, the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form, so he could actually see something was happening. And what does God say to him? Very first thing, and he says, "You are my son whom I love, with you I am well pleased." So Jesus, he is the audible voice of God, and he knows he's the Son of God. And yet God comes and he tells him, you are my beloved son. I'm really pleased with you. If Jesus needed to hear that, we need to hear that too. And it doesn't matter how often we've heard it before. You know, there's always times in our lives when we need to hear God say to us, you know, I'm so pleased with you. You are my son. You are my daughter. I love you. You're amazing. Because life is tough. And after that, you know, Jesus is led into a desert experience. He needed to know who he was. Philippians, so if he needed to know that, we need to know that too. Philippians 2 says, asks us to be like-minded with each other, and having the same mindset as Christ. It says, make my joy complete. That's Paul talking. Being like-minded, having the same love, being one in the Spirit and of one mind, having the same mindset as Christ Jesus. This is... I just recently read this cool scientific fact, and that's Donald Hebb, a neuropsychologist. He hypothesized that neurons that fire together wire together. So what he was meaning with that is that, you know, groups of neurons connect in our brain as a result of the experiences we have and the knowledge we have and absorb. And they form, so whenever we have a new experience, whenever we have a physical sensation or a feeling, thousands of these neurons wire together and form neural network pathways. And this, when we experience things together, when we engage with other people and their insights, we develop the same neural pathways. So that means if someone shares an insight that causes like an experience and an illumination and creates convictions in you, you begin to imitate the neural pathways in your brain, the same ones that they have. And they discovered when brains were studied, it was found that there were similar neural pathways in both brains where the same experiences happened and the same knowledge is shared. So that kind of means when we share testimony, when we experience things together, we grow alike in our brains, which is kind of cool. And if you think about that, as we grow together as a community, what happens when you share insights or knowledge or experiences from God? when he tells you, you know, you're my beloved son, you're my beloved daughter, and it creates convictions in you. So the work of the Holy Spirit in that way goes a little bit deeper than just giving us a nice bit of information. It's actually formative. It forms us, forms our brains, forms how we think. And when the Holy Spirit convicts Jesus that he's the beloved God, Son of God, and when he tells us the same thing, we start being like-minded with Christ Jesus in the, you know, best possible way. Okay, so that's the first purpose of the Spirit, the assurance of our identity. Jesus needed to hear it. We need to hear it. After Jesus hears that he is the beloved Son of God, that he is reaffirmed in his identity, Jesus is led into the desert. And the second outcome of that one, like the second purpose of the Holy Spirit, is described in Luke 4, 1 and 2. Now, he is led into the desert experience and he's tempted by the devil. The interesting thing about the passage is that it wasn't actually the devil leading him into temptation. It was the Spirit leading him into temptation. So there was some purpose attached to that, and I'll go into that in a moment. But when he's in the desert experience, what does the devil actually challenge?
Identity.
Yeah, exactly. Just as Jesus comes and God has told him, "You are my beloved son. You know, this is your identity." That's what the devil questions. He says to Jesus, "Now, if you're the Son of God, then tell those stones to become bread. If you're the Son of God, then throw yourself down from the roof of this building." And the same, you know, we can expect the same to happen to us. When, as God works in our lives, as we have experiences with him, I'm sure the devil will lead us into a desert experience, and that is going to be challenged. Our identity of who we really are is going to be challenged. But Jesus was secure in what he had heard before, and he didn't, you know, he didn't give in and try and, you know, make the stones become bread. So that's the second purpose of the Holy Spirit. It's that he gives us victory over sin and the devil. First one is assurance of identity. Second one, he gives us victory over the devil and over temptation. Some of you may remember that a little while ago, and again, it just illustrates the point, Edgar received a phone call from this pastor, and the pastor had been, he had read Edgar's book and then rang up and said it really meant something to him, because after he read it, he, you know, he became more hungry, and he said he had been an alcoholic for a long time, except no one really knew that. So, but it's, and he had tried to give up alcohol before, but it just didn't, you know, he gave it up for a little while and then fell back into it. But he said this one time, he was just totally desperate, and he said, you know, I just can't handle this by myself. Holy Spirit, God, you need to help me. I can't do this. And then he had this experience in his office all by himself where the Holy Spirit fell on him, and he said he felt like it was like electricity going through his body. And that's really like Isel was talking about, you know, it felt like electricity. And since then, in a moment, like the cravings were gone, and he said he even developed a distaste for alcohol. And at that time, he felt so close to God, he started developing a prophetic gift. So again, like, Holy Spirit needed to be there. God needed to give him the Holy Spirit to actually really be able to conquer temptation. And that's the kind of power that we need to have as well. Assurance of identity, first purpose, second purpose, to conquer temptation, to live holy lives. And the last one follows, if we read Luke 4, it tells us that after Jesus had, he was baptized, then he was led into temptation, and then it says, Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in the synagogues, and everyone praised him. So straight after he finally conquers temptation, Jesus is led in the power of the Spirit and he begins his ministry. He doesn't start before, only after God has challenged him. And he says of himself, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." So the third purpose of being filled with the Spirit is that we receive power and we're commissioned to do our work, the work that God has set out before us. And that's why I think it's so important for us now to keep remembering, no matter how God may sometimes offend us, we need to be full of the Spirit so we can actually do what God is calling us to do as a congregation and individually. And I give you an example, you know, like we often tell Heidi Baker stories, but this one is just, again, you know, reading that, I'm thinking, that's the kind of power I want to work with. Like, I want to be so full of the Holy Spirit that stuff just happens. And as a congregation, can you just imagine if we're all so full of the Holy Spirit that people are touched around us, how much we can accomplish? And we can't do this by ourselves. So she says, there was a great outpouring in my nation in Mozambique. And it began when there was a great flood. Everything was flooded. She said it was horrible. They went out to help people. And she said it was so bad that women often would have to give birth in trees because everything was just flooded. So they went out in Land Rovers and in helicopters and tried to bring food and help people as much as they could. And she said the amazing thing was that during the time, whereas before they had led a few people to Christ, she says all of a sudden there were thousands that just came to Christ. It was easy. And she says, you know, like people sort of ask her, what did you do differently? And she says, like, we didn't do anything differently. It was like, all I can say is that it was God, like, and the Holy Spirit. God did it. So, like they usually did, they went out to this village at night, and she says usually it's totally pitch dark at night, but they had brought generators and they had a little bit of light. So they set up and they started, and she had a group of kids from the orphanage with them. And she said even though like when they arrived, the atmosphere was so heavy, you could feel like there was a spiritually heavy atmosphere. There was not a single Christian in that village. They were all different faiths. And they started preaching, and she says, the kids are really hard to depress. They just started singing and being happy. And so the kids spoke a couple of words, and then Heidi preached. And then she says, okay, now bring me the blind and deaf. And no one came forward. She said there was no deaf person, which is a rarity in that area. And people were still a little bit probably not happy with them being there. But a couple of villagers came up and said, oh, you know, there's this one man, he's paralyzed and he's blind and he's in his hut, so that's why he can't come. Would you come and pray for him? So they go off, they come and come to this hut, and she says, this guy's got a... it's a really random thing, but she said, I realized he had this... The Smurfs on his sheet, and he said, "I have no idea how, you know, someone way out there gets a Smurf covered blanket, but here he was, and he couldn't even see it because he was blind." So, and he didn't see. He said he had a headache. They prayed for the headache, and the headache went, but still he couldn't see. And then she said, "Oh, you know, like, do you want to know Jesus?" And he said, "Yeah, yes." And him and his entire family gave their hearts to Jesus. And Heidi said it was just amazing to see, because really he wasn't healed. He was still blind, and yet he had the faith. And he said, "Yeah, no, I want to see Jesus." So before she left, she said, "Look, if anything changes in your condition, send me a runner to Pemba, where she lived. That's a couple of hours away." So people would have to run for a couple of hours. And then they went back to where they were before and continued with the preaching. By that time, people started stoning them, and she said the visitors that she had brought with them locked themselves in her Land Rover and told her they were interceding for them while the kids and her were standing there being stoned. but then she said one of the girls, she spoke about Jesus, and then she said, oh, you know, like if there's any blind people come up and we will pray for them, and a blind person comes up, Heidi and the girl, they pray for the blind person and they see. And she says the guy, like he obviously had worshipped some other god, but as soon as that happened, he grabs the microphone and he yells, hallelujah. And then he began speaking about Jesus, and he says, those are her words, the one they're talking about is real. I was blind and now I can see. And as a result, the villagers all come forward and they give their hearts to Jesus. So she says that happened on the Thursday night. Then, you know, they left back home, and by Sunday, no runners had come. With news that the first blind man could see. So on Monday, she was sitting in her car with another business person, and again, that guy was not a Christian, and they were just talking, and someone taps on the car window. And the guy, the business person, is a little bit like, don't open it, because, you know, it's not always safe to talk to strangers in that part of Africa. But she rolls down the window, and the guy says, I'm the runner. And then another guy comes up next to him, and he says, like he's a runner too, and he says he can see and he can walk too. He's on his land farming. How amazing is that? And then as a result, because that happened when the business person was sitting next to her, he heard that, and as a result he said, you know, whatever you have, I want to have as well. And he gave his life to Jesus. So that's why we need to be full with the Holy Spirit, as God is calling us, and I know he's calling us to do to a greater, you know, so far we've reached out into the Lutheran church mostly and to other mainline churches, but I know that God is expanding our territory and the people that we need to talk to. And as we do that, we need to be full with the Holy Spirit so that we have results like that as well. I make one last point, and that is that receiving the Holy Spirit is experiential. Like last week when people were walking through the tunnel, those people who went through, you kind of know something happens. And the experiences, they vary. Like some people just feel a strange, I think Edgar told that story a while ago, this one Anglican guy, was it Wesley, who said he felt a strange warming of his heart. So it may just be that. Other people, they have like electricity running down their bodies, like the pastor who talked to Edgar. On Pentecost, people knew that something had happened. You know, that it was violent wind. They experienced stuff. It can be prophesying. It can be, you know, it can be different things, but it is an experience. And I know that most of us, we probably already have experienced something, which is good. But I'm thinking, oh God, I want to experience something new. I want to experience something that I haven't experienced before. The guy Richard I was talking, the Ugandan pastor that I was talking about before, he said that in all those years of ministry, like for 25 years, they had 3 worship services that were so full with the Spirit, so full with the glory of God, that he could not stay in the building. He had to leave. And we're a bit like, seriously, why would you? And he said, no, it's so, the power, the presence of God is so strong, you can't stand it. So he left, and he said that when that happened, the floor was electric, and people actually had to stand on chairs because they literally could not stand up on the floor. And from the chairs, they were slain in the Spirit and fell down to the floor. And we're like, wow, I haven't experienced that. I wouldn't mind that. And he said also in one of those experiences, it looked like people were sort of slammed into the wall. Now, again, that probably doesn't look like a terribly spiritual experience, but he said it was, you could feel the presence of God. And it looked almost like a domino effect. One person after another sort of landed against the wall and slid down to the floor. So, you know, It sounds a bit, like if you want to take offense, it sounds a bit offensive. It's a bit, you know, well, people can be filled with the Spirit sitting on a chair, yeah? But God does things the way he wants to do them. He wants to stay in control. And I think for us, and for me as well, that's why I was challenged with the whole experience with people laughing. I was challenged to sort of go, you know, like, it doesn't matter, like, as long as I know that's you, God, everything is fine, but I want to experience more of you. I want to be so full with the Holy Spirit that I, you know, like, even just people being in our presence, walking into this building, they receive a touch of the Spirit, they're healed, or they're convicted of their sins. That's what I would like to see. So, we will be offering prayer now, to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I would encourage you that, you know, you have experienced the Holy Spirit before. Ask God for something new. Ask him to work in your life in a way that he hasn't before. Ask him to fill him so much that you are ready to do what he's calling us, what he's calling you to do. Amen. So if I could ask the prayer team to come up.